Hello, I'm Cheryl Hawkins. Welcome to UDC Books. It is considered that in the early 20th century, modern African-American culture was born right here in Washington, D.C. Before Harlem and the Apollo Theater, the U Street corridor was the place to be for African-Americans. The best of business opportunities, housing, entertainment, education, all developed right along the U Street corridor. On this edition of UDC Books, we're talking about U Street. The book is Washington's U Street, a biography. The author and my guest is Blair A. Ruble. Blair is the director of the Kennan Institute and the Comparative Urban Studies Program at the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars in Washington, D.C. He is also the author of several books about the governance of cities worldwide. He is a jazz aficionado, prominent urbanist, and longtime resident of Washington, D.C. Blair, welcome to UDC
Books. Thank
you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming. Been trying to get you here for the longest, so I'm glad this finally
glad
happened.
Glad it's worked out.
Yeah. Before we get into the book, I would like, if you would, tell me a little bit about the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars and more specifically about the Kennan Institute that you're the director of.
Well, the Wilson Center is the official presidential memorial to Woodrow Wilson, and Wilson was an internationalist and a scholar, so when Congress was trying to decide how to memorialize him, it voted in the late 60s to set up a living memorial, which was an international center for scholars. And then in the 70s, the center began to focus on different regions of the world and set up regional programs focusing on, in our case, what was the Soviet Union. There's a Europe program, an Africa program, an Asia program, Latin America program. So we run seminars, we have scholars in residence, we provide background knowledge about various parts of the world.
Mm-hmm. Woodrow Wilson was an interesting president, and I have visited the Wilson House, the Woodrow Wilson House,
right,
which is a museum here in D.C.
Yeah, it's an interesting house. It's a little snapshot of Washington in the 20s, but he is a very interesting figure. In terms of this book, he actually is, there's nothing heroic about Woodrow Wilson at all. He was responsible for undermining a lot of the prosperity that was along U Street when he resegregated the federal government. And in fact, more than half the segregation laws in Washington, D.C. were passed under his administration. So in terms of the story this book is about, he's actually a rather negative, dark figure sort of hovering over the city.
Uh-huh.
Because he was the first Southern president, first Southern-born president after the Civil War, and he brought all that baggage with him.
Yeah, yeah, and you've got a lot of that in this book. I'm really, really impressed with the, and I've read somewhere too that the amount of research and the mm-hmm. history that's in this book. You don't necessarily, I'm not necessarily seeing that much DC history. Mm-hmm. In a book, especially when you're talking about a neighborhood and how it all fits together. So, and starting off, I think I've heard you say that you got the idea to do this book from overhearing a conversation in a jazz club on U Street.
Not just overhearing, but participating,
okay,
in a conversation.
Tell us about that.
My wife and I were at Twins Jazz, which is on U Street, and it's a very congenial place, and lots of diverse people are there, and everybody's very friendly, but there was one night, 7-8 years ago now, where there was an edge to the conversation, and it happened to be the week that the Ellington condominiums opened up down the street, and the whole issue of gentrification was right there in front of everybody's eyes, and mm-hmm. and people were upset about it, and we began talking about why.
Right.
And it became clear that U Street has a special meaning in Washington African American community. And the more people talked, I think about the world by writing books. So the more people talked, I thought, well, I should write a book about this. And the more I delved into the story, I not only understood why it was important to people like the people in Twins Jazz 7-8 years ago, but I also began to understand that it's a window on the story of the city as a whole that often has been overlooked.
Absolutely. I think I read in here that you had written that the story of Washington has has been denied its own story for as long as it's been without its own representation in the federal Congress.
So in other words, since the beginning.
And
the idea is that if it's a real city in which real Americans live, then the people who live here should have all the full rights of citizenship. Mm-hmm. But since the city was established in a compromise, a compromise leading up to the ratification of the Constitution, you had this problem that the people who lived here didn't have the rights, full rights as citizens. So the way you psychologically deal with that and politically deal with that is to say, well, it's not a real place. They really aren't like everybody else. And then, but I think that's part of the story, but it goes beyond that because few people realize that Georgetown, Alexandria, when it was part of DC, Washington City, all had elected local governments. We didn't have representation in Congress, but we had local elected governments. And that was suspended at the end of the Reconstruction era and the beginning of segregation. It was suspended by Congress, and it was suspended because there were, quite frankly, when you go back and look at the record, too many black men voting in the city.
Mm-hmm. And we talked a little bit before we started this this interview, the fact that there were blacks and whites in this city all along. They were here, and you were saying was
right.
One of the most...
Well, one of the things that's interesting about Washington is it was established in between the two states that had the largest slave populations. So there were slaves working fields where all the major monuments of our government now stand. Mm-hmm. And that meant there was always an African-American presence in what became the city. It and Baltimore were the two American cities that had a majority free African-American population when the Civil War broke out. But the free population was much larger in D.C. than in percentages and in numbers than any other American city. So it always had, African-American culture and society have been part of the city from the very beginning.
Right.
And that's important for the story. But you mentioned that it was a much more integrated city. The U Street neighborhood, when it first grew up after the Civil War, in fact, was economically and racially integrated. You had a pattern where you had big houses being built on the streets where more well-off people lived, usually but not exclusively white. And you had alleyways where poor people lived, often African-American, but also poor whites as well. And so there was a lot of people really weren't living on top of one another. And it's only after Jim Crow laws take effect after 1877 that the U Street neighborhood in the city begins to really become very sharply demarcated mm-hmm. by race.
And that's something I didn't know too, that whites were living in these alley homes as well. I thought they were all just African Americans living in the alley.
Well,
they were all poor.
They were all poor, right. They were all poor, and some were immigrants, and some mm-hmm. were people moving in from the countryside. And the pattern was the first place you would go would be Southwest Washington. And there were two reasons for that. One, it was kind of cut off from the city. There were canals that it was often referred to as the island, even though it wasn't strictly an island. But the other reason is boats would come in at the foot of 7th Street, and people arriving in the city would begin walking up 7th Street and out what became Georgia Avenue, which goes off to Baltimore. So it was the first place that newcomers to town hit. Mm-hmm. So poor people, when they were coming to town, didn't have a lot of resources, may not have known anybody, so they kind of stopped along the 7th Street corridor.
Mm-hmm. And so after the Civil War, mm-hmm. during Reconstruction, you had a lot of, federal mandates going on that helping blacks to find their way, if you will.
Right.
A lot of the freedmen Burials and all that came about, and here in D.C.
Well, D.C. was important because D.C. is always the place where Congress wants to experiment. So when you had Reconstruction, their version of the experiment was, we're going to try out, this is where slaves were first emancipated.
Right.
It is where African-American suffrage really was first tried out.
Mm-hmm.
The Freedmen's Bureau tried a lot of experiments here, which led to, indirectly, but it did lead to the founding of Howard University,
yes.
Freedmen's Hospital. All the institutions become central to African American Washington really took root in this period after the Civil War. And part of it was because Congress imposed the Reconstruction mandate on the city. I think in terms of African American suffrage, I have the figures in the book, but I think only one or two people in Georgetown voted to let African Americans vote.
Yeah, you did
vote.
Have that in there. Sorry.
And Washington City, it may have been 30 people voted
mm-hmm.
for it, but in fact, because Congress had sovereignty it imposed.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens is, and there are historians now writing about this, there's a woman, Kate Mazur, has written a wonderful book about it. You had a very vibrant interracial political system that grew up immediately following the Civil War. And as Reconstruction begins to become looked at unfavorably in Congress, and the Southerners begin to make their way back into power, the vibrant political life in the city is an affront to what they want. So eventually you get, in 1874, home rule is suspended.
Mm-hmm.
And the excuse is profligate spending, but in fact the record, the historical record is emerging, is pretty clear that race had a lot to do with it.
Mm-hmm. Now you study, you have studied a lot of cities, urban mm-hmm. Areas throughout the world, and you identify what you call the contact zones, a crack in the sidewalk. Tell me a little bit more about that whole concept.
Well, the zone of contact idea is a social science term, which maybe I kind of like crack in the sidewalk a little bit better. But the idea is that in every vibrant urban community, there are places where people who are different from one another crash up against one another. The transportation centers, marketplaces, central plazas, and I think this is where great cities become great. It's where people are forced in the coming and going of daily life to interact with people who not only aren't like them, but maybe people you don't like at all. And out of that kind of schizophrenic experience of having to share a space with somebody who's different and somebody you may not like comes a lot of creativity. And I think that's why cities are really very vibrant, culturally inventive places. It's that people are forced to do things that they might not quite want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And there are areas like this. Now, historically in American cities, these are often African-American neighborhoods. They're where white people go to do things they don't want to be seen doing. There is often a kind of hierarchy of power that's at work here, too. It's not, this is no romantic view of, mm-hmm. of golly gee, people come together
right.
and they're productive. No, it's zones of contact, but also zones of conflict.
Right, right. I found that really, really interesting. And you mentioned that after Reconstruction and Jim Crow laws come into effect. And you know what? You actually, and I didn't know, we all know the term Jim Crow, but I didn't really know
where it came from.
Can you share that?
It comes from a skit by a white minstrel performer who was very famous, and he did these skits mocking African Americans, and one of his characters was Jim Crow. And this goes back to I think it actually goes back to 1830s, 1840s, and minstrel shows were the most popular American form of entertainment in the 19th century, and he went around the country and everybody knew his Jim Crow characters. So when you began to talk about segregating people, the idea was putting Jim Crow in his place, and that's where it comes from.
And it's amazing, you can take a character and have it become a law.
Yes, well, but you know, it's very interesting. I once had I was talking to a gentleman about the United States who became, was one of the leaders of solidarity in Poland. And he said to me once, when you Americans are serious about something, you turn it into a circus. And the more circus-like something is, the more serious you are about it. And this actually fits that,
exactly.
That model. But I mean, obviously this became, for a city like Washington, it defined, in some ways still defines, what Washington is about.
Yeah. In this first, chapter, Ambiguous Roots, or throughout the book, you also include profiles of some mm-hmm. people who were, I guess, important, prominent within those periods of times. And I know there had to have been lots of people that you came across that you could have given a profile to in the book. Why did you choose the people that you chose to be profiled in your book?
I chose the people I chose in part because they clearly left an imprint on this particular neighborhood. General Otis Howard, the founder of Howard University, but there are many, many other people. I also wanted to try to find people that represented the period I was writing about, mm-hmm. and represented in some ways the best of the period that I was writing about. So it was a combination, I call this book a biography, not a history, because it really became a book about compelling human beings and compelling life stories. So I wanted to highlight some of those life stories. And, mm-hmm. and it's a story full of truly remarkable people.
It really is. And I'd like to talk about Alexander Roby Boss Shepherd mm-hmm. that I read. Shepherd Park, a neighborhood up near me where I live, is named after. Tell us a little bit about him. I found him to be a very interesting person.
Well, he grew up before the Civil War in Southwest Washington, and he was a plumber, and he was a businessman, and I think he began to first make money by supplying the Union Army during the Civil War. And at some point, he became connected with General Grant, who becomes President Grant. And he basically reconstitutes the city government as chairman of the Sanitation and Construction Public Works Committee. But it's the most powerful position because it controls money. Mm-hmm. And he rebuilt the city after the Civil War. He paved the streets, he put in the water system. So a lot of the kind of cityscape we think of as traditional Washington, these red brick post-Civil War homes, all are because of what he was doing. And the official kind of story on Shepherd is that this all costs a lot of money, and he spent money the city didn't have, and the city was going to be in debt forever, and he was profligate and wasteful and maybe corrupt, although Congress never actually could find any corrupt practices on his part. But it turns out the story is more complicated than that, because part of his electoral base were these African American voters we were talking about, who benefited from getting the jobs he was creating. Mm-hmm. And there's now a pretty, it's not the only reason why Home Rule was undone, but his relationship with African Americans is part of the reason why Congress took away Home Rule mm-hmm. for a century, 99 years.
Wow. And we're still dealing, fighting.
We're still dealing with it, yeah.
Yeah. Now, the streetcars come in. The neighborhood is changing. People can move away from this zone, if you will, if they choose to, and people were moving away. What did U Street become as people started to move out? The whites, I guess, started to move away.
Well, by the time you get to when Duke Ellington was born,
right.
He grew up in the neighborhood, it was already 85% African American. What's happening is as segregation comes in, it's interesting that U Street is part of the original L'Enfant plan, so there weren't restrictive covenants on deeds as you get further out, like in Shepherd Park. So legally, it could be a mixed neighborhood, but in reality, it becomes an African American neighborhood, and it becomes easier for whites to commute further longer distances. It becomes easier for African-American professionals to move around the city, too, because you have streetcars. So you have the city slowly expanding. And then, of course, the next big revolution comes more or less after World War II with widespread automobile ownership.
Mm-hmm. And you write that a lot of black businesses sprung up really out of necessity.
Right, right. Part of the story, there's a clear evolution in the African-American community along U Street that I think is an important story. And you have professionals who maybe were more class conscious than they were race conscious. And because of segregation, they're forced to create their own businesses, to create their own social clubs, their own, support their own churches, create their own institutions. And then in the beginning of the 20th century, there's a very interesting generation that's born more or less around 1900. And again, Duke Ellington is part of it, but not just Duke Ellington, a number of remarkable people who already began to react against segregation. And some of them go off and get PhDs, and some of them go off and get law degrees. And after World War I, they become the focus of what becomes the civil rights movement.
Mm-hmm.
And it's that generation that is born in a community that had educational opportunities, that had professional opportunities for people. So after they go off and get their degrees, they come back. A community of great pride. One of the mm-hmm. themes that runs through the story is how proud people are of the neighborhood. Going right. back to where I started, and you had me start in Twins Jazz on U Street, it's neighborhood pride.
Yeah.
And it's a really big, important part of the story. And that's the generation. Paul Dunbar writes about how they were different.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a really important group of people.
Mm-hmm.
And they dominate the story into the 50s and 60s.
Yeah, my dad and mom, born in 16, my dad tells me they were here in D.C. all the time. They saw every mm-hmm. show that came to the Howard Theater. They went to the Griffith Stadium to see all mm-hmm. the baseball games. So, and then I had relatives living in D.C. So D.C. was always, for us, children mm-hmm. growing up, a wild place to go to, you know, because we knew African Americans had places to go. And
now you mentioned the Howard Theater, and I want to say a few words about that because I write about the Howard Theater in the book, but I think it really goes to the heart of the story, and I didn't get it quite right in the book. Going around talking about the book, I realized there's a much bigger story there.
Mm-hmm.
What was remarkable about the Howard wasn't just that you had all these famous musicians playing there, but the role it played in the community. And kids hung out there,
yeah.
and they got to meet these famous musicians,
right.
and they got to play. And there's a whole group of musicians that fanned out in the 40s, 50s, and 60s. They played with James Brown and
yeah.
Elvis Presley, and they were formed because they could hang out at the Howard Theater.
Yeah, I've heard all kinds of stories, too. People skipping school, kids,
right.
so they could
right.
go down to
it
the
It was
Howard.
A real part of life.
Yeah.
And it meant that the famous musicians weren't like now where they live in some world you never inhabit. They were right there. Chuck Brown,
mm-hmm.
the famous mm-hmm. DC godfather of go-go.
Right.
He is on a TV show talking about how when he was a kid shining shoes, Louis Armstrong came out and he shined his shoes and gave him a dollar tip, and he
wow.
thought, well, being a musician must be a good thing. So it had that, and the son of the Turkish ambassador hung out there and then goes on and starts Atlantic Records. It was exactly that zone of contact. It
mm-hmm.
was where people came together and were transformed mm-hmm. by what was going on.
And we don't have time to go in through all of it, but not only on the entertainment side, I found it interesting that you talked about that in the white communities they created citizens associations, and then the blacks created civic associations. But these associations were, I guess, created to help community.
Right, right. And what's, well, it was a kind of code word in the intricate dance
yeah.
of racial
segregation.
They
weren't really citizens.
Right. And they weren't the same, you know.
Right.
It's a very layered, complicated story.
Yeah, the whole story is, and you share it very well and very beautifully in this book. All the way Black Broadway through Chocolate City, the last colony, and all the way now to where U Street is today, the mm-hmm. new U, with the regentrification that's come through. Talk a little bit about what U Street looks like today.
Well, I stopped the book with Barack Obama the day before he's inaugurated. He goes to Ben's Chili Bowl. Because it seemed to me that was a moment that captured the story.
And sort of put U Street back on the map.
Back
again.
On the map, that's right. But what has happened is U Street is now in. Places like the Ellington condo opened up. In the last census, the area right around U Street is no longer majority African American. And the city isn't majority African American
right.
anymore, and so it's gone through a dramatic transformation. And you know, it's where you stand and how you look at it, you see very different stories unfolding with gentrification. On the one hand, there's a sense of loss that mm-hmm. many people clearly feel because U Street was part of their life, and when they go there now, they don't feel as if it is part of their lives. But there's also a gain. It's very vibrant, it's very vital, it has a great nightlife, entertainment life. So like all things in life, it has pluses and minuses.
So is it still a contact zone?
Yes.
Great.
More so than ever.
All right, thank you so much, Blair.
Thank you very much.
Time.
Thank you.
My guest has been Blair A. Ruble. His book is Washington's U Street, A Biography. In great detail, this book traces the history of the neighborhoods of U Street from Civil War era origins to recent gentrification. Blair Ruble has carefully and beautifully fulfilled the task of creating a unique body of work that captures the history of this culturally important area. Washington's U Street has been called a rare instance of original research told in an engaging and compelling voice, a sentiment of which I wholeheartedly agree.
You. Thank you very much.
Thank you for watching. I'm Cheryl Hawkins. Please join us again next time, and until then, take care.